Hey guys, so not too long ago, I got a very awesome message from Tanya Hurley herself saying how much she loved my podcast and how she posted on the Ghost Girl page. And I really want to thank everyone for ca who came up yesterday. Thank you so much. I mean, I appreciate it very, very much, and I really hope that I can get at least a lot. I can get a lot more likes and views and everything. So thank you so much to everyone. You know, it's great, you know. And that I just want to thank you guys. So without further ado, let's talk about the third chapter of the first book, and welcome to the third episode of the Ghost Girl podcast. So the third chapter is called Awake, and throughout in this chapter, Charlotte is awoken after her death, and she doesn't know that she's dead yet though. She's just in the first scene, she's talking about her premeditated brushes about Damon. And how she's beating herself up, practically saying, "Well, great, he asked me to help him, and what do? I pass out." And so she kind of, you know, she kind of beats herself up about it. And she quotes a very old poet saying, "We can't change our skies. We can change our skies, but not our limits." And then she talks about how a 20-year-old, 2,000-year-old Roman poet probably had a better grasp of her life than she did, and she thought it was disappointing. So she thinks she's alone, but she's not. She's got the gummy bear, and it's taunting her like the talking Tina doll in the Twilight Zone, in a Twilight Zone episode. And she sees the gummy bear on the floor, but she can still feel it in her larynx, and she's like, that's fair, that's odd. And so as she's trying to remember what happened, the PA system comes up and calls her down to room 1313. Now, note, she's never been there before. She's never been there before. She's never heard of it, and she's really, you know, she's never been there before. But she practically knows where it is. It's like she's drawn to it. And as she's going down to room 1313, she hears Annabelle Lee, and it says, it was just one section from it, but our love, it was stronger by far than the love of those who are, for those who were older than we, many far wiser than we, and neither the angels in heaven above, nor the demons down under the sea can ever dissever my love for the soul of the beautiful Annabelle Lee. And so that's just, yeah. And as she approaches the door, and she gets kind of nervous, you know. She doesn't really know what this room is all about, and so she says, "Walk this way," pinching her nose and attempting the best young Frankenstein that she can do. And as she walks down there, her footsteps fell silently. That kind of gives you a hint that she's, you know, that she's dead. They describe how the basement looks, you know, and how dank and dark it is, and it's, you know, it's, but it doesn't really, nothing's really happening. Like the pipes have condensation on them, but, like, oddly enough, they're not dripping. She approaches the door, and she goes in. Like I said, she's a bit nervous. And she's there, and there's a she's there, she thinks she's getting ready to sign up for AP classes. You know, she's really excited. She's like, well, could this day get any better? So she gets up to the recipient, the reception desk, and she hears the song, Terry Jackson's song, Seasons in the Sun, playing low volume, and she thinks that how could this song ever be a hit because it's not that great, and she thinks bummer, you know, kind of a very like really low setting, you know. And she calls to the back because no one's there. She thinks no one's there, and she calls to the back that she's been called to the office, and the receptionist comes up and says, "Oh, sorry, I didn't mean." She comes out of the under the desk, and she's like, "Oh, sorry, I didn't mean to yell." And she's like, "No one, no one ever does, sweetheart." And she hands her a bunch of clipboard filled with paperwork, and she said, "Fill this out. And remember to give me back my pen." And that's really weird. And she said if the woman was a people person, she wouldn't be stuck in a high school basement working by herself in a virtually in virtual isolation. So she turns around and she notices a girl with long curly orange red locks and bright Kelly green majorette outfit, and this is Pam. But she didn't really notice her before, and she sits down and trying very much to make eye contact, but she has absolutely no success. And she says, "Hi, I'm Charlotte," and tries to attempt to shake hands with her, but nothing. And so the girl's practically, she thinks she's deaf, you know, but she's not. And she's gotten this kind of treatment before, but she's never gotten it from a new girl, so you know, she's kind of like, this is kind of odd. And she thinks that maybe people talk about her out of school, and then she's like, well, no, that can't be right. And so it says, on the top of the first page of the paperwork, it says new student, and she says, and she's all excited, and she says, so this does mean I got the AP classes. And she's filling it out, and she sees COD. And she's like, COD, cash on delivering. I shouldn't have to pay for AP classes. This is public school. And so she leaves that blank and everything, and she says, and she hands it back to the lady behind the counter, and she says, "Here's your ID," and it's a tag. And she's like, "Thanks." And she hands it, and she's like, not sure why she need she didn't she doesn't know why she needs a new ID. So she takes it back. She takes it, and she puts and she's there's a little band around, so she puts it around her wrist, and it's, you know, in circulation off. And so she the lady gets up and goes to this huge jumbo filing cabinet. And she says, "Okay, one more thing. I need you to confirm." She pauses, turns, and nonchalantly opens a large drawer that this is you and fill out here. And Charlotte is stunned. She can't believe it that she is seeing right before her eyes her silent graying corpse, and she's stunned. She's just overwhelmed and is freaking out. And pinned to her new her new day, day first day of school outfit is the gummy bears, which is how she died. And of course, she finds out the COD means cause of death. And the secretary instructs, and so she starts to kind of melt down at this point. She's like she's freaking out, and she's backing away. And she bumps and makes a fan fall, and on top of that she falls too, and her hand goes into the blades, and one by one her fingers were chopped off right at the middle knuckle by the twirling sights. Her digits went flying off in every direction, spraying the room. She clenched her eyes shut and waited for the pain and the not and the nauseating warmth of spurting blood to arrive, but it never came. Confused, she muttered all her courage and opened both eyes ever so slowly and looked. Her hand, which should have been mangled and destroyed, torn to pieces, was completely unscratched. She held it up and examined it over and over, mesmerized. And the girl from the Pam, she gets up, and she helps her up, saying nothing can hurt you anymore. And she says, "I'm Pam, and you're, well, you're." And Charlotte's like says, "Please don't say it. Please don't say it." And she whispers dead in her ear, "You're dead." And that shoots through her ear like nothing before. She freaks out, and she practically, it's like it's she kind of remembers everything from third person. She's like, okay, she starts to feel the coldness in the air. She starts to feel, she knows this is the waiting room, you know, this is where it happens, this is where she dies. And she, you know, she has a meltdown, and she has this otherworldly scream where she screams, but nothing really comes out. And she's just, and "You're dead" echoes through her mind, and she's just rattled, and her, and she's just overwhelmed, you know, and she's just crazy about it. And she runs out of the room and up the stairwell, and that leads us to chapter 4. Again, I want to thank you guys for, you know, for one, liking my podcast and visiting it. I really, really thank you, thank you, thank you so, so much. And I especially have to thank Tanya Hurley for discovering it. I don't know where I would be without your books. And, you know, I just, oh, thank you so, so much to everyone. And I mean, thank you. That is like, this is the greatest honor. And thank you so, so much. And I will see you guys next time. Bye.